Hi, I'm Bob Herbert. Welcome to op-ed.tv. A terrific new book takes us through the history of New York City by recounting the lives of fascinating individuals who, to say the least, are no longer particularly well known. The book is The New Yorkers, 31 Remarkable People, 400 Years, and the Untold Biography of the World's Greatest City. The author is my friend and longtime former colleague at the Daily News, the New York Times, and now here at CUNY TV, Sam Roberts. Sam, welcome. Congratulations on this book. I mean, you've written a lot of wonderful books. I think this is your best one yet.
Bob, thank you so much. Thanks for having me.
So there's so many fascinating stories. I mean, I don't even know where to begin with this, but let's go way back and start with John Jay. And John Jay is kind of an odd one because he is pretty well known, but not for the reasons that you go into in this book. We're talking about the late 18th century, the aftermath of the Revolutionary War. New York is not in great shape, to say the least. But John Jay took steps that sort of set us on the path to where we are now. Talk about that.
Well, we all know that John Jay was the governor of New York. He was the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court. What we don't know, or certainly I didn't know when I started researching the New Yorkers, was the instrumental role he played in bringing New York back after the American Revolution. This was 7 years of brutal British occupation, so that at the end of the war, New York was known as Canvas Town because there were so many people living in tents. So in 1784, John Jay was coming back from Europe. He had negotiated the Treaty of Paris ending the war, and Congress said, we want you to be the Secretary of Foreign Affairs. And John Jay said, forget about it. You know, I want to go back to New York. I want to practice law in my hometown. And they said, you got to take this job. We need you. And John Jay said, I'll take it under one condition. Congress is meeting in Trenton. This is the seat of government. I'll take it if you move the capital of this country to New York City, to my hometown.
A lot of people have no idea that New York was once the capital, so this was a huge deal.
It was a very big deal. So Congress agreed. This is the only time a member of Congress hijacked the seat of government to where he wanted it to be. They moved the capital under the Confederation Congress to New York from 1785 to 1789. And then when the Constitution was adopted in 1789, that became New York City. Federal Hall became the capital of the United States for 2 years.
Right.
And that was instrumental in reviving New York City. And I'm a contrarian. I believe that by leaving New York City, in 1790, going to Philadelphia and ultimately to that swamp on the Potomac, New York City was saved because it could become the capital of capital and not be hidebound by a federal bureaucracy.
I couldn't agree more. We got kickstarted by the fact that it was the capital for a couple of years.
Right.
But then we were better off that it didn't remain the
exactly
capital.
Exactly so. And the fact that Congress was here, that Washington was inaugurated here, that the Bill of Rights was passed here, all of these things made New York City come back so that by the time of the first census in 1790, New York became the largest city in the country and stayed that way ever since.
So until the mid-19th century, New York City meant Manhattan. But then a fella named Andrew H. Green, and you profile him in your book, he made his presence known. And then that really put the city on a path to what we understand as New York City now. What was it that Andrew H. Green did?
Well, Bob, you're right. Andrew H. Green was known as the father of Greater New York. It's amazing how we know so little about him now. In fact, he's one of the New Yorkers in the book who, you know, for most people, never heard of. One of the criteria in the book was that these were characters who were transformative or emblematic of something transformational, but yet were either forgotten or were largely unknown. And Andrew H. Green was the person, more than anyone else, who brought what became the five boroughs together, consolidated as Greater New York in 1898. Now, some Brooklynites still regard this as the great mistake. 133,000 Brooklynites voted in a referendum that was supposed to be non-binding in 1894. It carried in the city of Brooklyn by only, I think, 133 or 200 votes. Pretty suspicious, right. Small margin.
Especially in those days.
And I would say now, too. it carried nonetheless, and Green brought the five boroughs together. They became Greater New York. It was celebrated mostly in Manhattan with very mixed feelings in Brooklyn. And what makes the story even more remarkable is the kind of stories in this book that you can't make up. Andrew Green winds up getting murdered after consolidation in a case of mistaken identity, in a lover's quarrel.
Having nothing to do with his official duties.
Nothing at all. It just makes the story of New York, the pathos, the drama of New York, all the more remarkable.
Apparently a lover's quarrel in which he was not one of the lovers.
Apparently not. as best we can tell, apparently not. It was a case of mistaken identity.
Well, now you've got us kickstarted onto our next person, because I have here, it's time for a murder mystery. And in this case, we're talking about a fella named Levi Weeks and his bride-to-be, Elma Sands. Now,
yes.
Why would this story end up in your book? What's
the
significance?
Good question. This is the beginning of the 19th century. It merits a mention in the New Yorkers for a couple of reasons. One, it was the first recorded murder trial. There's a transcript of it, which is just amazing when you look into the details of it. Second, you can make an argument that he got away with murder. If he didn't get away with murder, there is still somewhere out there a murderer
right.
who we don't know about.
Right.
But also, he was defended by a legal dream team that you could never make up. It was Aaron Burr and Alexander Hamilton.
If you were writing a novel, and then
or a musical, for that matter.
Or a musical, exactly. And decided to put them together as a dream team. People would say, come on, Sam,
right.
stop it.
But
this is reality.
It was reality. It was very well put together, both as lawyers and as press agents, because they each represented different wings of politics at the time. So that by having both of them as lawyers, Levi Weeks managed to attract as big a constituency as he possibly could to his cause, and the jury found him innocent. Was he innocent? Well, you know, we leave it to the readers of the book to make their own determination.
Dream teams come up with these verdicts.
They certainly do.
There's a reason people put them together.
Absolutely.
So the city was pretty well segregated, going way back, which is not at all surprising. A lot of it is segregated still today. But anyway, riding on public transportation could be a problem for people who were African-Americans. And that brings us to an extraordinary woman by the name of Elizabeth Jennings.
Bob, she is one of my heroes in the book. New York, we forget, was in a way a very southern town. There were more slaves in New York than any other city except Charleston.
Slavery was a big deal for New York economically.
It was enormous. New York was the financial backer of the Cotton South. We insured slaves in case they had run away or in case anything else happened to them. We shipped slaves to this country. We shipped cotton out of the country. New York was amazingly dependent on slavery before the Civil War for financial reasons. And Fernando Wood, who was the mayor of New York before the Civil War, even contemplated secession, joining the South in seceding from the Union in sympathy with the slavery movement, even though New York was also a center of the abolitionist
right.
movement. But in the early 1850s, Elizabeth Jennings played the organ at a church downtown. She was a school teacher. And one Sunday morning, she was late for church, and she ran to board a Third Avenue trolley. And the conductor kicked her off.
Right.
Kicked her off because she was a black woman. And she sued. Her father was a well-known, fairly prominent member of the black community, the black middle-class community. In fact, he was the first black man in America to get a patent and earned it because he was a free black man. If he were a slave, he would not have been eligible for a patent. She sued in Brooklyn Supreme Court. She hired a young lawyer named Chester Arthur, who later became president of the United States.
Do you believe it? These things are not to be believed.
No, these people come out of the blue.
He became president of the U.S.?
And he was a young lawyer, had tried hardly any cases. He won this case, and she was awarded $500 from a jury, which was more than her annual salary as a school teacher. The judge cut it back. He said, in effect, $500, probably too much for any black woman to get as an award. But she won this case against the Third Avenue Trolley Company, and the jury and the judge said, she's a woman, she's a black woman, she is well-behaved, she is well-dressed, there is no reason to exclude her from public transportation. Now, this didn't solve the problem of segregation by any means, but we have to remember this was 100 years, almost to the year, before Rosa Parks won her lawsuit in Montgomery, Alabama. And nobody knows Elizabeth
Incredible.
Jennings. Lost to history.
Right.
Lost to history until a elementary school class in 2007 managed to persuade a city councilwoman to get a street corner named after Elizabeth Jennings in Lower Manhattan. And yet nobody knows her. Nobody knows her name, and lost to history until she thankfully gets mentioned again, reappears in The New Yorkers.
Incredible. She didn't get her $500, but she did get a financial settlement.
She did get a financial settlement, and she later remained a school teacher and stayed that and lived in West 41st Street in Manhattan until she died at the end of the 19th century.
Now, if public transportation was a problem for African Americans in those days, and it was, housing would have been an even bigger problem.
As it is.
Exactly. It remains squalid well into the 20th century for most black people in New York City. So now, enter a fellow in your book named Philip A. Payton, Jr. And this is, I mean, there's so many fascinating characters in the book, but he's kind of amazing.
He is amazing. And Bob, he's the son of a barber, comes to New York like so many other people to make his fortune, or at least to survive, to do better than he would have done barbering in Massachusetts. And he goes into the real estate business. He literally starts at the ground floor. In fact, I say he really started in the basement as a janitor, but goes into the real estate business, and he does what so many other white real estate brokers do later on. It is sort of the opposite of blockbusting.
Right.
In Harlem, a neighborhood that is mostly occupied by Italians, Jews, Germans to some extent, a fairly middle-class white neighborhood at the time, he starts putting black renters into buildings that are predominantly occupied by whites.
This actually is blockbusting.
Well, it is. You know, it's maybe reverse blockbusting in a way, but the stories in the New York Times and other papers are just amazing because it talks about a real estate race war in Harlem because the whites are fleeing. They're afraid of living with black neighbors, black renters, and the white real estate owners, people of great prominence in the city, are selling out these apartment buildings because they can't rent them to whites anymore.
And you can tell from your book that all these discussions about race and fleeing because blacks are moving in and property values and they're terrible folks or whatever is all in out in the open. It's not like the current day where you try to cover your racism or whatever. They're just out there blatantly saying whatever it is that's motivating them, and it's being covered in the newspaper.
That's right. They're saying, get me out of here, you know, and Payton is throwing, you know, blacks in these and telling the whites, you got to get out here because I'm renting these apartments to blacks. And advertising in the newspapers. And, of course, blacks are moving in from Chelsea, from Hell's Kitchen, other places where they're getting discriminated against. They're paying higher rents in Harlem than the whites were paying.
They're paying higher rents even when their landlords are black.
Yes,
they're paying higher
indeed.
Rents than they would be charged to white tenants.
They're getting discriminated against no matter what.
God.
They're at the losing end. But they are getting good housing
for
the first time. Now, what was Payton's motivation? Was it revenge? Was it racial equality? Was it making money? Probably all three. Hard to sort that out. But he became the father of Black Harlem. Whether this was by design, whether it was inadvertently or not, his real estate practice made Black Harlem, if you will. He wasn't that successful in the practice because he probably overreached, but he was more responsible for making Black Harlem and ultimately the Harlem Renaissance and all the good things that came with it, probably more than any other person.
I can't imagine how the Harlem Renaissance could have occurred without this having happened, you know, just a kind of a short while before we know about the Harlem Renaissance, because you wouldn't have had the concentration of that talent there. You wouldn't have had those writers and poets and musicians and artists and you know.
This was a black lower middle class movement. It wasn't a movement really of
exactly.
poor people, and it wasn't into slums. This was into mostly new, relatively good housing, and these were people who, for the most part, could afford to pay their rents.
The Duke Ellingtons of the world, living up in Harlem, in many instances, living in wonderful properties. I mean, you know, really terrific housing and stuff. We have Mr. Payton to thank for an awful lot of that.
We do know. Unfortunately, the places that many of those people performed, blacks still couldn't go to. It was for the whites downtown who patronized those places.
When I was younger, and my family was into music and loved jazz and everything, so I knew all about the Cotton Club and stuff. When I first heard that the Cotton Club was segregated and that blacks were not allowed to go into the Cotton Club, even though Duke Ellington made his name there, I was like stunned. As a kid, I almost didn't understand how to process that.
Well, how could you? I mean, it's the kind of thing that makes you want to cry. I mean,
yeah,
how
exactly.
could you possibly imagine that people in the neighborhood, people that spawned that kind of talent, were denied the enjoyment of hearing it, listening to it, seeing it?
Right. So crime is a serious issue in every big city. But New York City, even today as we speak, is much safer than most other large cities, and certainly way safer than it was back in the notorious days of the late 1980s and early 1990s, when it was, you know, sort of like the Wild West, if the Wild West was as wild as people claim.
Probably wilder than the Wild West.
Probably wilder than the Wild West. But a fellow who deserves much of the credit for this transformation, for the increased safety on the streets of New York, was a real character. I mean, he seemed in real life like a fictional character, and his name was Jack Maple. And you tell Jack Maple's story, and he was an unlikely guy, to say the least, to be sort of the point man in this move toward greater safety on the streets of New York. Tell us about Jack Maple.
Jack Maple, a high school dropout, a guy who really was going nowhere, from Queens. His father said, you got to get a job, you got to get hired, you got to take a civil service job. Luckily, he gets hired as a transit cop, works his way up, and thanks to Bill Bratton, who became the commissioner, and then, of course, policies followed through by Ray Kelly, the commissioner. Jack Maple comes up with a plan, which sounds like amazing common sense. Let's not just Let's not just react to crime. Let's not just arrest people who commit crime. Let's figure out how to prevent crime. Let's see where crime is being committed. Let's get a sense of who's committing the crime, and let's deploy our resources through decoy cops, through preventative measures, so that we can anticipate where the crime is going to occur and stop it before it happens. And he, you know, when you look at his CompStat program, which is basically applying statistics rigorously to where that crime is occurring and trying to anticipate it, he, you know, if anyone, was probably instrumental for putting that matrix down on figuring out where the crime was going to happen and cutting that crime rate in the late 1980s and through the 90s in ways that nobody would ever have imagined possible.
Well, you know, it was remarkable what he did, but almost as remarkable, maybe more so, is how he got to the position where he was even listened to. This guy was a loser. I mean, I learned from your book, his father was worried that he was really going to go down the wrong path as a teenager. He tried to be a police officer. I think he actually was about to go on to the police force when there was a hiring freeze.
Right, right.
So he didn't get to go on to the NYPD. And then he ended up in the transit police, which was separate in those days. But talk about talk about what it was like to be a transit cop in those days and his unlikely rise to a position of power in the NYPD. How did that happen?
It happened through very unusual circumstances. You're right. I mean, he was a maverick. He was a renegade. He was the kind of person who ordinarily would have been thrown out on his ear, but he kept making arrests.
There was that.
Yeah. I mean, you know, he was doing what a cop is supposed to do. And, you know, the brass, which is always hidebound in the police department like any bureaucracy, particularly a paramilitary organization like that, was forced to listen to him. And when Bill Bratton came in particular, he realized this guy knows what he's talking about. He made these massive charts of...
Bratton came in initially
as head of the transit police,
right.
And that he took him with him when he became police commissioner. And Rudy Giuliani deserves some of the credit for bringing them in, deserves some of the blame for kicking them out.
Driving them out, right, exactly.
Right? Bratton was smart enough to say, this guy is a weirdo. This Jack Maple, you know, is strange. He wears Hamburg hats, he wears spats. He looks like Damon Runyon or
right.
one of the characters out of Guys and Dolls. But he knows what he's talking about. And whatever the affectation, he's onto something. And it worked. And people began to listen to him because he really hammered this home and he held people accountable. 2,200 murders a year down to, you know, the low hundreds.
You and I were out there covering it. I certainly wouldn't have imagined it, you know, and it's remarkable.
No, and there were other demographic factors and other things you could attribute it to, but a lot of it was this strategy of saying, we're going to try to figure out how to prevent these things instead of just responding to them, and Jack Maple belonged in this book.
CompStat has now become sort of the template for policing in big cities about everywhere.
Everywhere, and also, Bob, for all sorts of other things, sanitation, for all sorts of other measurements of how you can hold people accountable, how you can hold the bureaucracy accountable, how you can say we're not just going to be reactive, we're going to create a set of standards, a set of goals, and try to hold people accountable to them. And that makes enormous sense.
So I'm going to take a point of personal privilege here. When I was a very little kid, 4 or 5 years old, and I used to go around with my father, who was an upholsterer, and he'd give estimates and on jobs and stuff like that. And we'd listen on the car radio to a program called Tex and Jinx.
Mm-hmm.
And for some reason, even at that young age, I loved it. It might have been just the names, Tex and Jinx. I mean, there's something about the sound of it. But my father liked the show. I loved listening to it with my father. I'm kind of surprised they're not more well-known nowadays, but that was like such a long time ago. And then I'm reading your book, and there's Tex and Jinx. Tell us about that.
Tex and Jinx, again, that forgotten people who I think belonged in the New Yorkers. This is essentially meant to be a biography of New York City. And there's so many characters in the city that, you know, just are overlooked or forgotten, and yet who in their own way were transformative. And Tex and Jinx were sort of the birth of celebrity radio and television. They weren't the first, but they injected a note of gravitas that really wasn't there before.
Right.
They weren't flippant. They weren't frivolous. They interviewed important people, Bernard Baruch, leaders of state, professors, philosophers, and Tex was sort of the very serious, almost sonorous kind of radio guy, PR guy. Jinx Falkenberg was his wife.
Tex McCrary, I don't know if
Tex McCrary, right. Yeah. And Jinx was a model, and some people thought of her as sort of, you know, the dumb blonde kind of person, but she was anything but.
She wasn't,
very
that's
smart,
right.
And she asked questions that were so perceptive, and she got to the basics. She said, well, you know, what do you mean by such and such? And people were disarmed by these kind of questions, and they answered it in a way that radio listeners and TV viewers could then understand. And they were very, very popular, and they were all over radio and TV, and really set a standard for what we now think of as celebrity talk.
They had some amazing staffers working with that
program. Oh, they did.
Can you talk about that a little bit?
Yes, Barbara Walters, Gabe Pressman, Bill Sapphire, people who they mentored, who, you know, became the stars of radio, TV, Times columnists, and others who, you know, just went on to amazing careers and started with Tex and Jinx in this book.
Sam, it's a wonderful book. We've run out of time. There's many more characters in there we could be talking about. I've been talking with my longtime colleague, Sam Roberts. His book is The New Yorkers, 31 Remarkable People, 400 Years, and the Untold Biography of the World's Greatest City. Buy it, pick it up, read it, you'll enjoy it. Sam, thanks so much.
Bob, thank you.
That's all the time we have. I'm Bob Herbert. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.